You know, to start our worship service this morning, I want to share a scripture from John chapter 12. And as I read these verses, you'll see that this took place when Jesus was returning to Jerusalem and had just been at Lazarus' home where Mary anointed him for his burial. But in these verses, you see that developing plot against Jesus. But on this day that the scripture centers around, it was Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. This was the palm time for Jesus, the time when the crowds waving palm branches and praising him for being that hoped for Messiah and Savior. So from John chapter 12, starting at verse 9. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and putting their faith in him. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, and as it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified, and that's another word I want you to think about today, is glory or glorified. And it's saying that only after Jesus was glorified, only after his death and resurrection, did the disciples realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." Hosanna. It's a word, an exclamation that means save now. So I want us to kind of get a feeling for the excitement of that day, the time when the crowds greeted Jesus with palm branches and praises. And to do that, I want to use a song that was written by Michael W. Smith years ago called Hosanna. It's got a celebratory tune, so good time to wave your palms, dance if you like, yeah, whatever. But not only the tune, but also the words. It has very meaningful words such as, "Riding on in gentle strength, come to save your own, come to give life, the kingdom is at hand." So let us stand and join together.
Blessed is he who comes.
Would you join together in our unison prayer? Almighty God, on this day your Son Jesus Christ entered the holy city of Jerusalem and was proclaimed king by those who spread their garments and palm branches along his way. Let those branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as the Lord and follow him in the way that leads to life. In his name we pray. Amen. I share together in the hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, continue our praise of Jesus by singing this hymn, remembering as in verse 3 it says, it was Jesus' passion, his suffering and death on the cross that brought him to Jerusalem in the first place, that brought him there on that Palm Sunday. And that suffering and death is what provided Jesus with his eternal glory and honor. So I see the kids, some of them already remembered. They go back, and the rest of us stand and sing together. Have you ever noticed how quickly things can change in your life? Like what? How fast? What's happened quick that's been a change? What's that? Okay. Well, it might be like you wake up in the morning and you're feeling fine and everything's good, and then by supper time, that night you're not feeling good and you're just laying around and feel like you're going to throw up or something. You know? It's how quick things can change, right? Or maybe you weren't having a real good day. I mean, something that you were excited about doing or someplace you really wanted to go and it didn't work out. But later in the day, you got a surprise visit from some of your friends or family and it was a good day after all. Well, I was with a friend of mine not long ago, and he told me a story about when he was a kid that reminded me of how quick things can change. When Troy was about 8 or 9 years old, he used to go out to his uncle's farm quite a bit and play with his cousins and do all kind of crazy stuff. Well, in one summer day, they were out there and they were riding bikes, and they like riding bikes down the hill behind the house and in around the barn. And everything was going fine until one time he came down the hill, and when he hit the turn, his bike hit the loose stones, slid off into a ditch, and he landed in the briar patch. Now, it was summertime, and all he was wearing was shoes and shorts, no shirt, and he's stuck in this ditch of briars. So his aunt and his uncle came out and got him, took him in, put him on the table, started picking out the briars and treating each scratch with methylate. Now, any of you old enough to know methylate, it doesn't feel good on cuts. So that's just how quickly things can change. And, you know, Jesus' last week on earth was full of quick changes. You know, from today, we celebrate him coming in Jerusalem, and everybody's praising him and waving the palm branches. But then a couple days later, those same people, or much of the crowd, were saying, crucify him, kill him. And that's exactly what happened. You know, on Thursday, he was arrested and beaten. On Friday, he did die on the cross. But that wasn't the end of the story for that week either, was it? Because what happened the next Sunday? Yeah, he rose from the dead. Maybe some of you have seen the resurrection eggs before. We're not going to have time to go through all of them, but how about if I give you one? Let's see, I'll take this yellow one. Okay, and how about a blue one? So, yeah, you guys can work together. So we're going to take a look at three of these and think about Jesus last week and how quickly things changed for him. So let's open the blue one up first and see what's in there. What's there? Why would there be a donkey in there? Anybody? Oh, boy. Well, you go first, and if you're not right, we'll go to him.
Because he rode on a donkey to Jerusalem.
Ah, hey, is that what you were going to say? Yep. Jesus rode on a donkey to go into Jerusalem, and that was significant in itself, because when the people thought Jesus was going to be not just a Messiah, but a king that would free him from power of Romans, and when kings came in, they usually rode big white stallions, but if you came in on a donkey, that meant that you came in peace, and it was a sign of humility. So Jesus rode the donkey in, and that's when the crowds praised him. So that's what we celebrate today on the Palm Sunday part of Palm Sunday. But let's see, which one? The yellow one. What's in that one? Okay, a cross. What's it made out of? Yeah, let's see. Yeah, it's made out of metal. That's really supposed to be made out of nails, reminding us of Jesus being nailed to the cross, that he died willingly for our sins. So Sunday, you know, everybody's treating him like a king, like a celebrity, that, hey, this is maybe the Messiah we're waiting for. And then a few days later, what?
He went on the cross because they thought he was going to be like a king, but he said, no, I don't want to be your king.
That's right. Yep, that he said, no, I don't want to be your king. That's not what I came for. Yeah, I came to be the Savior, and the way he did that was to give his life willingly on the cross as the perfect sacrifice for our sins so we can be forgiven. So what's in the blue one?
Nothing.
Why nothing? Why nothing? What happened the next Sunday? Yeah? Yeah, that signifies the empty grave. So, you know, just think about all those changes that happened that week with Jesus. But none of that took Jesus by surprise. He knew it was going to happen, and he actually told his disciples that ahead of time, many different times. Now, certainly, as we were waving our palms and we think of Jesus coming in, Jesus was glad that the people were excited to see him, but not for himself, not because he wanted to be popular, but he thought that they were beginning to know more about God through him. But he also knew what lie ahead. He knew that the reason he came back to Jerusalem was to die on the cross for our sins. And he had to die in order to come back from the dead, right? That meant that, you know, he conquered death for us too. So as we think of all the events that took place in that one week time, we know that Jesus did it for us. Okay. Let's pray. Lord, there's so many things to think about as we think about Jesus' final week. And we just ask that as we go through this week, that we not only remember it, but that it takes on new meaning. And we realize that Jesus came for us to forgive our sins, to give us new life. Remember that He did it willingly for us, and the difference that it can make in our lives now and for eternity. So we give you thanks, and may we continue to grow in your ways and become more like Christ each day. Amen. Amen. Now, if I can have my eggs back, you can go back. Okay. As we come to our prayer time today, are there joys and concerns to share with one another this morning? Let's join together in prayer. Lord, the life we live here on earth is always full of changes, and some of them very sudden and abrupt. Some are joyful and some are anything but. But we know that you're with us each step of the way, and you can draw us closer to you and teach us through all the experiences. We do have many concerns on our minds for many who are battling diseases, for uncertainty of what's ahead and the futures, of needs that we bring before you this day. And we think of all the turmoil in the world around us, and it weighs heavy on our hearts, and we just pray that you would give strength and peace and protection to those that are caught in the middle of so much conflict. And we pray that you would change hearts from hatred to care, and that you would continue to lead and speak by your Spirit. We thank you for the healings. We thank you for the many blessings that you give us, Lord. And help us to remember that you are the source of all good, of all truth, and of eternal hope. We see that as we remember Jesus' reason for coming to earth, to be our Savior, to give us new life and eternal life. So may we live with that hope and rise above and overcome all the circumstances that this world throws at us. We just ask for your continued grace. Help us to grow into Christ-likeness through your word and through your ways. And as we think of this, we think of the way in which Jesus taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And as we continue with our remembrance and celebration of Palm and Passion Sunday, I ask the choir to come forward.
Flowers invest for better liberation. where Jesus predicts his death. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Could we bow, please? Lord Jesus, we thank you for this grand opportunity we sometimes take for granted, this time of worship where we can leave our thoughts, leave our cares behind and come in, and just thank you for the many blessings, the many miracles that you have arrayed us with throughout our lives. Help us, Lord, to remember those times that we thought we were just lucky, that we didn't really recognize your hand in some of the blessings that you had given us and many of the miracles. So we come to you, Lord Jesus, today with thanksgiving for everything that you've done for each of us. And we ask your blessing upon Pastor Larry and Sue as they come together to worship you today through what they're going to be preaching and saying to us. And also look after Pastor Bill and his family as they're down in Florida, traveling long distances. Please keep them safe. So we ask all this and more, Lord Jesus, in your most precious name. Amen.
Our scriptures from John chapter 12 today tells us about the conflicting realities Jesus knew he would endure that final week in Jerusalem. In these verses, John describes how Jesus experienced the three P words that we begin today with, and those words were palm, plot, passion. Okay. So we're going to take a look at how those words related or describe Jesus' experiences and also how they describe ours. You know, Jesus knew the need and expectations of the crowds who praised him with the palms. This crowd had experienced Jesus' teaching about God with uncanny authority. They had seen him do many miracles, include numerous healings of physical, mental, and spiritual sicknesses, and even raising some from the dead, most notably and most recently, Lazarus. Jesus had confronted the corrupt religious leaders on many occasions, and he knew the plots against him. And Jesus knew that his soon coming passion would take place. Now, passion here, it means to endure suffering, to have agony as a martyr. It really kind of comes from the Greek pathos. And Jesus realized all this as he was entering the final days of his earthly life there in Jerusalem, where he would continue to teach, continue to confront false religious practices, where he would suffer and die as a perfect sacrifice for God for the sins of all who trust him as Savior, including us. Now, Jesus, being God in human form, knew all this was going to take place. But what a tumultuous week of events. You know, from the palm-waving praises of Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, to the cries of crucify him a few days later. It's a real triumph to tragedy as Jesus suffered the agony of beatings and crucifixion. But through all that, Jesus not only was rejected by much of the crowd, he then was deserted by even his closest disciples. And you remember on the cross, Jesus was rejected and forsaken by God when he took upon himself the sins of the world. Now, in his humanity, all this deeply troubled Jesus, as John says in 12:17. But yet, as God's Savior, his Son and our Savior, he knew that this suffering, the rejection, the abandonment, was the way for him to enter his glory, the glory of God. The central event of Jesus' glory wasn't the palm-waving crowds, but it was the cross. And Jesus said, "Should I pray, Father, save me from this hour? No, this is the very reason I came. So, Father, bring glory to your name." Jesus' obedience to God's will of humbling himself, not only with the confines of humanity, but dying a criminal's death on the cross, fulfilled God's plan of grace and salvation. And then that put into motion Jesus' glorious resurrection from the dead. Now, for us today who know the rest of the story of Jesus' death and resurrection, we still marvel. We marvel at Jesus' teaching, at his healings and his miracles. But the real grace, the real gift to us is trusting in his sacrificial death for our sins so that we can be restored. That we can be restored to our holy God, be free from guilt, and assured of eternal life with him in his glorious kingdom. So that's really our praise. That's really our palm time, our palm celebration, experiencing that new life that Jesus provides for all who trust in him. New life now and for eternity. Now, as we live each day, we're to keep growing in our personal relationship with Jesus. We're to experience more of that true peace and hope that he provides. But we still live in this fallen world. Live in this fallen world where Satan has many plots against us. Plots to try to separate us from God's truth and grace. Now, these plots can come in the form of many things. It can be hardships or tragedies. It can be evil acts by somebody against us. Satan's plots for us are things that can deceive us. Deceive us by saying things like, "Well, Jesus' sacrifice for sin, that's just too good a story to be true." Or, "You know, right here, right now, this life we're living, that's all there is, so indulge all you can." Or Satan can plot against us through our abilities and our pleasures, deceiving us to devoting our time to totally the things of this world instead of seeking first the kingdom of God. Now, we have many blessings, and we're to enjoy our blessings in this life. We're to be thankful for them. We're to use them in our service to others in Jesus' name. And when Jesus lived in this earth, he did just that, and he touched many people. So much so that he often attracted large crowds that demanded his time and attention. But it was not Jesus' success or popularity that brought him glory. That's not when God's name would be glorified. It was through Jesus' obedience to his purpose in coming. His purpose to willingly die as the perfect sacrifice for sin. So again, Jesus' glory was realized not through his popularity, but through his passion, his suffering, and his death. In John 12, when Jesus said, "This is the very reason I came to earth," he said, "The Father, bring glory to your name." And then a voice from heaven said, I have already brought glory to my name, and I will do so again. Verses 30 and 32 of John 12. Jesus told the crowd, "The voice was for your benefit, not mine. The time for judging the world has come, when Satan, the ruler of this world, will be cast out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself." Jesus said this to indicate how he was going to die. Jesus' death is our victory over sin and over Satan's plots to separate us from God. Now, in this verse, when Jesus said he's got to be lifted up, he means being lifted up in the cross. And three times in the Gospel of John, Jesus described that. Described that he was going to be lifted up so he would be able to bring all people to himself for forgiveness of sins. So there's a song that I learned years ago, and hopefully some of you know it too, but it's easy. And it's one that has stuck for me, maybe it will for you, to remember about Jesus being lifted up. And it's simply called, "If I Be Lifted Up." And I think, there we go, we've got words for it. So we're just going to sing through that chorus part first, and I think you'll catch on from there, okay? He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me, that the Father be glorified." You guys must have been practicing. So let's do that again. He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me, that the Father be glorified." And then it changes a little bit for this verse. He could have summoned legions of angels to save him from the cross. But if they came and saved him from dying, this whole world would still be lost. He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me, that the Father be glorified, that the Father be glorified." Jesus said that like a kernel of wheat has to die when planted in order to give new life and produce many new kernels, he had to die. He had to be lifted up in the cross to produce a plentiful harvest of new lives for those who trust in him. Our challenge, our passion, if you will, our passion of suffering is to remain faithful to Christ, to live differently from the world. Now, this is a difficult challenge, difficult in our secular, self-indulgent world, but we must remember that Christ overcame the world, and he commands us to do likewise. Verses 25 and 26 of John 12. Jesus tells us that those who love their life in this world, those who feel completely at home here, will lose their life. But those who care nothing for their life in this world will keep it for eternity. "Anyone who wants to be my disciple," Jesus says, "must follow me, because my servants must be where I am. The Father will honor anyone who serves me." Now that anyone is anyone who lives out their faith for Christ through their daily actions. You know, through the times of poems and praises, through the plots and deceptions, through the passion, rejection, suffering, and death, Jesus remained faithful to his God-given purpose. He challenges us to do the same, so that we too can bring glory to the name of God by living righteously and sharing the good news of God's grace through Christ and that eternal love with others. So, Hosanna, save now. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. We're going to end with a song of praise. It's got two titles, at least in my mind. My Savior's Love, or I Stand Amazed in the Presence. But it talks about Jesus' love for us. So may we stand and sing together. Continue to sing that in our hearts. As we go through this Holy Week, remembering of all that Jesus went through for us, I don't think we can ever understand it completely. But we can be ever more thankful for it and continue to grow in his ways and to live as much as we can as he did. So may we go forth in the strength of his Spirit each and every day. So go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen.